Blog Talk Radio.
This land is mine. God gave this land to me. This brave and ancient land to me. And when the morning sun reveals her hills and plains, then I see a land where children can run free. So take my hand, this land with me, and walk this lovely land with me. Though I am just a man, when you are by my side, with the help of God, I know I can be strong.
Oh, I love that song. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Yada Yah Radio. My pleasure to be with you this evening. Looks like we have Larry with us calling in from Florida. Hello, Larry.
Hi. I'm here. I'm definitely here, Yada.
That's good. I appreciate your help today on the Shattering Myths program.
You know, JB's in bad shape over there. I mean, he's really, really... really bad off. He's had a fever for a week. That's a lot.
Yeah, he started, so that those of you all might know, JB thought that he had just some kind of a bug, got a bad fever, a lot of soreness in the throat and the mouth, and kind of wondered, you know, what kind of a bug that might have been. Ended up checking into the hospital because it got so bad on Sunday. And went into surgery to have two of his wisdom teeth taken out that were impacted and badly infected, and then had to stay in the hospital 2 more days, 3 days total, to get intravenous antibiotics to try to knock down the infection. Finally, he was released from the hospital, but still has been battling this. This has been a real struggle. I have some personal sympathy. Much younger than JB is, and obviously I'm much younger than I am now, I went in to have all four of my wisdom teeth taken out because they were impacted, and evidently I'm wired differently. It's probably not a surprise to many of you, but I'm plumbed differently, I guess would be the right term, than most people, and there are veins in my jaw that most people do not have when they knock the wisdom teeth out. They cut those veins, and there was no way to put pressure on them to stop the bleeding. And I lost 4 or 5 pints of blood that just spilled out all over me and all over the operating room floor in the dental surgery office. And they had only one bag of plasma that they just kept around for emergencies. They never had to use. They used it to keep me alive temporarily. But that was almost my last act, was getting my wisdom teeth out. So I can sympathize with him. Never had those kind of problems, Larry?
I've never had that problem, no.
No?
I never have. Thankfully, I've never had it. That's pretty rough.
Yeah. I just see the headline here that the chief condescender of the United States said that Trayvon could have been him, and now he's playing the race card as if sympathy is due to... a kid that had narcotic issues, a kid who had been suspended from school. Tell you what, if Obama was a significant user of drugs and had been suspended for school and had been caught for defacing school property and with stolen property,
and then went out and jumped a neighborhood watch,
he probably wouldn't have gotten the scholarship to Harvard. So this idea we're trying to sanctify this brat. You know, being a brat doesn't mean you should be dead, but he's responsible for his own death.
I've got to tell you, I live here in Florida, as you know.
Yes.
And I can tell you the last time I took Yalda and actually a woman named Farishte downtown, there were 40 of those thugs, and they're young men with their pants down, and they watched us, and they watched us leave our car, and I said, oh, I don't even know how I'm going to get out of here. And thankfully, a cop pulled up and actually literally parked his car by my car, or I wouldn't have got out of there without a shootout.
Yeah.
No way.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. There is racism.
I mean, this
alive
is,
and well.
These, are,
and
these kids are not kids. They're miniature hitmen. They're killers.
Yeah, and they don't work.
You know,
I mean, a huge preponderance of them do not work. They get food stamps. They get welfare. They're parasites. And you know,
they're despicable. And,
this
and
is,
by the way, if
the problem here is how do you classify this without having a racial overtone? But
well,
you know, if you
tough.
You know, if you look at the riots that took place right after this verdict in the downtown Los Angeles, they were all the same. You look at what happened after the hurricane went through New Orleans, and there was all of that looting.
Didn't you read some statistics the other day? Do
yeah.
you know? I
85
mean,
times
all,
more likely for a black to assault a white in a violent
36,
crime. Than
36. 18 more times likely to murder.
Yeah, 18 times more likely to murder, but it's 80 times more likely if you take all forms of crime. It's whites are 80 times less likely
to commit that crime.
Commit that crime against a black than a black is against a white.
Yeah, well, see, and this is where we need to have the racism discussion, because there is an awful lot of it in the black community that is not in the white community.
Correct.
And frankly, you know, it's just a time if they want to have a discussion about race, if they want to make this a national debate about race, so we don't talk about the IRS scandal, and we don't talk about Benghazi, and we don't talk about all the rest of it. Well, you know, let's go ahead and have that discussion.
But we're going to have that discussion, Larry, based on evidence and reason. And so what you're going to find is that the reason that there is such a problem here is that the nucleus of a family is far less prevalent. It's something
been eviscerated.
It's just eviscerated in the African American world. African American boys aren't raised with a father at home. A minority of African American boys experience the what it's like to be raised by a father, and a disproportionate of African American families, the father does not work. He's not known, and he does not work, and so they're brought up not valuing the benefit of working. And, you know, even in our relationship with Yahowah, if we're not willing to work at it, it doesn't have any value. In fact, work has gotten a dirty connotation. You know, working at something, engaging, acting upon something is actually a beneficial thing. If you don't produce something of value, if you don't contribute during a day, your day is wasted. You've accomplished nothing. You don't feel good about yourself. You haven't gained anything. You haven't grown. You know, it's why the covenant isn't based on faith. It's why it's based on engaging and acting. And unless you're willing to do that, and unless you have been raised in such a way that you recognize that that's fun, that that's enjoyable, that that's productive, that that's uplifting, and I don't know about you, but I get distracted, and there are days where I get nothing done that is, at the end of the day, I've accomplished nothing that is useful, and I go to bed that night, and I feel pretty yucky. I don't know if you
well,
have
I'm,
days
I'm
like
hearing,
that. I have days
you know,
like that from time to time.
It happens to all of us from time to time. I mean, what I can say, though, is that you're either going to lead a productive life or you're not. And if you're going to sit around and not lead a productive life and roam the streets and look for trouble, chances are pretty good you're going to find trouble. And, you know, in the very end, I'm just tired of hearing about racism. I've posted a lot about it this week on FB. And, yeah, let's have the discussion about racism. And you know, when we get there, now let's start having the discussion with the black community about why we don't harm others that are not of our own race. And I'm sure those over in South Africa are going to agree, too, if they're white. I mean, you know, they talked about apartheid. Apartheid what? They said They had 380 political prisoners killed in 10 years. There's 60,000 dead, 60,000 dead white farmers. And we got Nelson Mandela out singing songs about killing white people. Of course, now that worthless, sleazy lawyer is dying, thankfully. The world will rid themselves of that parasite.
But he's been canonized. We have turned.
He'll be turned upside down. He'll have God status, the same as Martin Luther King Jr. did.
Tiger Woods was at a golf tournament this week, and his big thing was he walked into a room where Nelson Mandela, who was really a ploy of the CIA, a puppet that we elevated to power.
Yeah, that's right.
And
somebody wasn't given enough gold or diamonds.
Reading a newspaper, and Tiger Woods said, "You feel the energy, the aura in the room."
Wow. Please.
We have elevated men to the status of divine, and the men that we have elevated are for the most part, are rubbish. They are.
I have to tell you, good
people.
That's right. And I have to tell you, if I'm to think of the four most overrated people in modern history, I'd have to say they're Thomas Jefferson, Martin Luther King Jr., this clown Mandela, and Gandhi. And I would also give credit.
I would differ with you a little bit in the sense that I think that the more I read about Jefferson, the more I realize that, Jefferson really had it right as it relates to the Quran. He had it right as it relates to Islam. He had it right in terms of Paul. He wasn't a Freemason, but he definitely had some leanings towards the Jacobins. But his words relative to federal power, he was right on
correct.
About that. He was anti-religious. And so I would view George Washington as the real snake in if you were to take a single guy in America. But I think worse than Washington was Lincoln, and we've canonized Lincoln. We've made him a saint.
Yeah, that too. But still, all these big names, and they all have God status.
They said
it. It must be.
Oh,
true.
Gandhi. It's almost like saying an apostle.
Managed to get 2 million people killed and set up an Islamic state.
And my worst two, of course, I view Paul as the worst, as the most negative influence in all of human history.
And Muhammad.
And I would take Muhammad as second. I'd probably have Akiba in my third spot, and I might have Constantine in spot number four. And in terms of influence of the modern world, I might have Adam Weishaupt in the next place. But this actually, and I know this is not the purpose of this program, is to talk about human foibles. But one of the things that I am so thrilled that we have collectively learned is something that I had really no idea. I mean, over time, we came to realize that the religion of Christianity was wholly inconsistent with Yahweh's testimony. And over time, we've learned that the United States government and governments around the world, there's people living and listening to us in other countries, that governments aren't reliable, and that militaries make matters worse. They don't protect people. And so we have learned that man's institutions aren't trustworthy. I did not know, really, until writing the introduction to God, quite honestly, I did not know that there really were five specific terms and conditions of the covenant, and I didn't know that Dode wrote a whole psalm, an entire song, specifically to draw our attention to those terms and conditions of the covenant, or that God is insistent that we abandon our allegiance to religion and politics. I sensed it. It resonated when I was confronted it. But the more we listen to our politicians and watch them and see the disaster that we're making around the world with our human institutions, boy, it becomes ever more obvious that it is man versus God.
Oh, yeah, and by the way, I want to add in here for all the black listeners, I don't worship white people. I'm not a member of the white supremacists. They make me as sick as the black racists that pull white people out of their cars and beat on them.
In fact, my favorite
many
of
the white
the
lords are ruining the world. They're ruining the world. So, yeah. You know, this is not some
My favorite person to call the show is actually not you, Larry. It's actually William.
Yeah, he's going to call in tonight. I talked to him.
Yeah, William, and so,
William, of course, is Puerto Rican, by the way.
Okay, he's Puerto Rican. Okay,
he's one of my PR buddies. Yeah.
Well, William is probably the most genuinely good man that we have the opportunity of encountering. And we're going to finish this, and we're going to go to Yah's testimony. While it is inappropriate to ever make judgments based upon skin color, there have been and there continue to be cultural influences amongst groups of people that would be ignorant and irrational to ignore. Now, it doesn't mean that everyone that is, for example, let me give you an example, and it doesn't mean that everyone that is part of a particular culture is going to have the positive or negative characteristics.
Of course not.
And that we all, by joining Yahweh's covenant, develop the exact same characteristics, which are all beneficial. But if you want to look at the greatest minds in terms of just knowledge, not necessarily wisdom, Jews have it over other races.
Oh, I know.
And you look at scientists and the like, and great discoveries, there is a tendency there. There is a tendency in the Asian community to value education and to work hard. In the average Hispanic family, you are likely to find more people willing to work and even work in non-glamorous jobs than you are in the average African-American family. There are tendencies. Germans have a tendency to be industrious, to be engineers. French have a tendency to be artists. And I think that rather than saying that the differences are a sign of racism, I think, there are things to celebrate.
That's
I
wouldn't exactly
want a world where there were no
right.
artists. I wouldn't want a world where everyone was a scientist.
What you don't do is go rip somebody out of their car because they don't look like you and beat them. If you do that, you are an animal, okay? It's simple.
Yes.
Plain.
Yeah.
Simple. I've never attacked anybody over their race. But I can tell you, it's getting to be a pretty sorry affair to sit here and tell people how racist I am. I don't have a racist bone in my body.
No.
You know, so
but,
I'm not.
You know,
sit here
I've been
and
mugged
intolerated.
I've been mugged 3 times. 13% of the American population is African American. All 3 times I've been mugged, they've been African Americans.
We had 6 engines stolen last year. All 6 times, they were Africans and 1 African-American. And I mean literally African.
Wow.
So that cost me something in the neighborhood of, overall.
So we have a community issue of sorts that needs to be addressed in this country. And if I were to drill down on it, I would say that the primary issue is the lack of a nuclear family of mothers and fathers who value making a sacrifice for their children and for their home, and that the very covenant concept that Yahowah created, as he as the father is going to be the greatest giver. He's not only going to be the lead instructor, but he's going to set the example. He himself is going to lead by example, and he is the one that's going to get down on his knees to lift his children up, and his primary goal is to have his children grow and appreciate wholesome values that are good for them. And when we individually as people migrate away from the value system that he established in the family and how the covenant is designed to work, then we suffer. And the further a community gets away from that, the more they're prone to raising kids outside of marriage and abandoning children and abandoning the value of work and abandoning making sacrifices for the benefit of your children, which isn't really a sacrifice. You know, you gain more than you give when your gift is to your children.
Oh, absolutely. I've got 4. I can
And that is the model of the covenant. And so when we get away from that, that's when we get into trouble.
Oh, that's right. You know, and that's right. But, I mean, the whole racist thing, I'm tired of hearing about it. I'm really tired of hearing about it. I'm tired of it.
We were in Yashayahu, Salvation is from Yah, 9-2, as the program came to a conclusion last week. And it we were beginning the amplification of the passage. It is the people or the family, it's Ha'am, who walk. Walking is a super, super big deal. It's Ha'halak. There is no way to overemphasize walking as it relates to Yahowah. Now, here it says, who walk in darkness. Now, you might say, well, that's walking in the wrong direction. No, it's because these people who are walking in darkness, I was walking in darkness. I was very political and very religious. I was walking in darkness. I saw the light. I was drawn to the light. I walked to the light. Walking is a big deal with God. And
interesting, too, that light is equated with truth.
Yes, of course.
That's the only way we can find the light is through the truth.
But it's also equated with not just enlightenment and truth, but also with purity and in eliminating darkness, which is in the presence of light, there is no darkness. Darkness is equated with lies. So in the presence of truth, there are no lies. If you want to rid yourself of presidential lies like this president, equip yourself with the truth, and his lies are all negated and refuted. But the other thing about light is that what is the catalyst for life? You can have all the water in the world, but if you don't have light, you're not going to generate life. And so it is that. But if you're in a ever gone out camping, Larry?
Sure.
Okay. Have you ever gone out camping on a moonless night?
Yes,
okay.
I have.
Have you ever tried to go for a walk while camping on a moonless night without a flashlight?
That's pretty rough. No, I don't. I mean, I've walked a little ways, but no.
So what does the light help you do when you're walking
it
and,
helps you see.
In darkness?
Sure, it helps you see.
It helps you see the path, right? God has a path. Sure. He has illuminated his path. Light is the beacon in that regard. When somebody is one of these survival shows and they're trying to eat and they're trying to drink water, what is it they have to have to purify their water and to make the food edible? Fire.
Well, you want to have a strainer.
Well,
yeah,
fire.
You want to boil it. Yeah, you
fire.
Want, yeah, you want to boil it.
Fire.
Yeah.
You know, fire is the ancient symbol of light.
Yeah. If it,
you know,
if
you
it's
want to,
horrible,
if you've got metals that you're trying to refine them, what do you need?
You need fire.
Right. Yeah. So God is not only light, but God wants us to walk to the light. And this, we have both God presenting himself as light, as or, as illumination and enlightenment, and so many of the aspects. That's, you know, it's God cheated. We can say that of him. He's not getting mad at us. He actually created the universe so that his metaphors were spectacular, and that they scream out to us in so many ways to enlighten us about his nature. And that is why light that comes from fire, he describes himself as Ish and Isha, the feminine and masculine manifestation of his light as fire, and why he equates himself to light. And here he is, he's telling us that we're in darkness, and if we're engaged, if we're walking, and we walk in that darkness and we see the great light, then we have hope if we walk to the light. But walking is important because the fellows that you were describing when you were driving and you were afraid for your safety, were they walking or sitting?
They were standing, you know, in a group, and they saw who I was with, and they liked it. And I saw him talking. I thought to myself, you know, how am I going to get out of here? Really, really. I mean, it was intimidating.
But they're not engaged. And that's the thing about walking. When you're walking, you're moving. You're engaged.
They were all leaning up against a wall, you know.
Right, and the wall doesn't need to be held up. That's right. Are you going anywhere if you're standing still?
No, you have to have.
Walking is engaged. Yeah. You know, it's side by side. It's making progress towards something. So, the people who walk in darkness, which is the void of light and ignorance and obscurity, they will see an enormous, great, and important light. That important light we talked about last week is that's the key that ties this statement that Yeshayahu is making about the arrival of the Messiah Yahusha to the announcement of the Messiah Yahusha's arrival in the opening chapter of Bereshit, when Yahweh is describing the uniqueness of the fourth day. And the fourth day, he says, the greater, the same gadol, this great, visible, and magnificent, important, and enormous, powerful, intense, and distinguished light is going to be a sign of the Moed. And so when we make those connections, fourth generation of humankind, fourth day, sign of the Moed, this enormous light, we now know that by putting these things together, that humankind, which is in darkness, is going to, in the fourth millennia of human history from expulsion from the garden, which would be 33 CE, that generation was going to see a great light in concert with the Moed, the meeting times of Yahweh. And it goes on to say, those who live in the realm of death's shadow, if we're in the darkness and we do not see the light, if we're not drawn to the light, then we are, even while we're alive, are we not in death's shadow?
Yeah, sure we are.
Yeah, there's no one that's going to survive this light and life unless they're in the light. And so it says those who live in death's shadows, the tangible expression of the light will make himself known by shining on them. Now, this is another aspect of God that I'm not sure I have properly visualized, but it's still evident. If there's a really interesting conundrum that God has in a way, if he goes too far, he's negating our choice. If God were to have remained as he was in the during the Exodus, where he was the booming voice coming from the brilliant top of the mountain, acting on a daily basis to provide water, to provide food, to keep all enemies at bay, and performing great miracles, speaking with a great voice, being constantly visible as God, then it becomes impossible to deny God. And so God can go only so far in making himself known to us without prejudicing the result, without making himself so obvious that we no longer have the option to choose whether or not we want to get to know him and love him.
Well, I think it's beyond that. I think it's the type of person he wants to know. For you, Craig, or Yada.
Craig's fine for this. The kind of thing that's turned out funny in Shattering Myths is that we haven't had any threats. You know, I chose the name Yada just because of the fact that I thought maybe being more incognito would be helpful in that, because I thought we were going to stir up lots of animosity, and we really haven't. And that kind of been...
That's amazing, really.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have thought that, but you know, the bottom line is, how many people once worked for you? I mean, say at the height of your business career.
4,000 probably at the
Okay, 4,000 or 5,000. And it's pretty hard to know if somebody really wants to get to know you and like you if you're in that kind of a position of power, isn't it? I mean, really. You don't know if they know you or like you or care about
you. What's interesting, by the way, is in a company, if you're doing it right, you don't feel like you're the one who is empowered or that you have power. In a company like that, you feel like you are the one who has to empower everyone else. You feel like the one who is responsible for everyone else. You feel the burden of that responsibility. I don't think I ever felt empowered while I had all of those employees. I felt responsible. I felt the burden of the responsibility. But in terms of people, when you're in that kind of position, what you find is that most of the people who approach you are disingenuous.
Right, and that's the problem, isn't it? And
yes.
So if Yahweh, you know, if he came down and said to anyone, I'm going to empower you times 10. You're going to be able to walk through walls. You know, you're going to be able to move at the speed of light. You're going to be able to feel better than you've ever felt. You're going to have more power than anybody on this planet.
Let me give it to you just so that you can sense it for a while.
Yeah. How many people would take him up on it?
Everyone.
Everybody. Yeah. And how many of those people would he really want to know? Apparently thousands.
Yeah.
So he's left it up to us.
Yeah.
To present enough evidence that we can go looking after him, and thus that makes us the kind of people he wants to know. That's the way I look at it.
That's the point I'm trying to make here, is that God has revealed his nature to us. Yosha in the Sermon on the Mount told us what we needed to know about him. And Yahowah told us in his Torah what we need to know about who he is, what he wants, what he's offering. And he provided enough insights, future history, if you will, through the prophets for us to be able to prove his existence. And so there is plenty of light from him as evidence that he is who he claims to be, that he's trustworthy, and what he's offering is reliable and dependable, and that if you respond in accordance with what he's offering, that you too will become a great light. But while that's all true, I think God only goes so far. It's kind of like the story of the prodigal son, where the son grew up with the opportunity of knowing the father, but the son, you know, rebelled, went off into the world, but when the son was returning, the father walked down that road. You know, God will reach out to us. He will make himself known to us, but he only goes so far. And if we don't respond, if we don't meet him along the way, he won't just stand there and keep on walking to us if we're not paying attention, if we're not trying to.
Why should he?
But I see it. Yeah, I really see it as a mutual thing here.
It is mutual, and the way I see it, it's completely a mutual thing. All relationships are mutual if they're real, you know. I've seen guys that, you know, they want to marry way over their head, and they have some woman basically taking advantage of them, okay? And I've seen guys do that, and it's really a sad thing because they don't really have a relationship. They're always chasing their wife around, which is ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's not a way to live. It's more exercise than I'm interested in, frankly. You know,
so those who live in death's shadow shall see the tangible expression of the light, and that tangible expression will make himself known by shining upon them. And that is really what God has done. I think he has done it primarily through his Torah, and I think he has done it secondarily through Yahusha. And if you look at Yahusha as the tangible, visible, illuminated manifestation of the Torah, then he's done it just through the one means.
Well, he is the Torah. Living Torah.
So there's really, to say there's two means, perhaps you just look at it as one. Anyway, light is the primary metaphor used to describe Yahweh throughout the Torah, prophets, and Psalms. This is for a variety of reasons, not the least of which is that light enables us to see. We talked about that. It is the means behind observation. You can't shamar observe without light. It's the catalyst for observation. It obliterates darkness, which is equated with evil, so it is the medium of perfection. And it reveals that which is true. So it's the source of enlightenment, knowledge, understanding. You know, there was that the tree there is the tree of the, and the garden was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And, You know, there's so many words in Hebrew where there's a dark and light side, and you've got to be able to think about it, just like in this passage. You've got to make the connections with other things that Yahweh has
said. What do you make of the tree of, I don't want to digress here, but the tree of good and evil? I mean, it's the tree of choice, the tree of options, isn't it?
That's exactly how I look at it. It's the tree of options. Is that when you're in the garden and you have, and you only know Yahweh, and you only know the joy and happiness of the garden, if you have no knowledge of what it is like to be estranged from him, if you have no knowledge of what it is like to be beguiled or betrayed or to die, if you have no knowledge of these things, then, you know, everything is bliss. And so that tree was provided the knowledge of good and evil, so it became the tree of choice. And now you to choose good, you have to be discerning. To choose good, you have to exercise your nesoma. To choose good, you have to use light to illuminate those things that you're observing so that you can come to understand. So light, for a variety of reasons, not the least of which it enables us to see, it obliterates darkness and it reveals that which is true. Yahweh transfigured himself before Yahochanan, Shimon, and Jacob. As light, they reported seeing him as light, and just as the Yehudim of Moshe's day had been nearly blinded by Yahweh's fire on Mount Horeb, and finally said, "Hey, could you tone it down a little bit? I don't have my SPF 7000 on." They actually thought it was over the top. Got scared. Now recently, I think the reason that Yahweh responded, because when the children of Israel said to Moshe, "Listen, you know, the booming voice and the blazing fire, it's just over the top. I mean, are we going to have to live in the presence of God like that forever? I mean, it's just way, way over the top." And God's response was, I thought, extraordinarily humble. God didn't say, "Wait a minute, I just saved you from slavery. I'm here, the God of the universe. I'm paying attention to you. You know, you aren't much to look at, really. You all stink. You know, what do you have to be bellyaching that, you know, I'm too brilliant, too loud? Boy, I could really turn it up, and I could show you who I really am, and I'd incinerate you." But no, God took it really on the chin. He just said, "You know, I get it. I understand. It's too great a difference between where you are and who I am. And that difference right now is uncomfortable for you. And it created the kind of separation that God is uncomfortable with." And I think he sided with the people. I think he genuinely recognized that the next time that I reveal myself to you, I need to do it in a way that's less threatening, that's less, gargantuan. And he does that two ways for us. One is he does it through his Torah. We can approach him in his Torah. He's not frightening or scary in his Torah at all. And the second way that he does it is that when we are adopted into the covenant and we are empowered to live with God forever, when we approach him in our eternal state, we are as brilliant as he is. We become like him. We become like light. And so there's no longer that difference. Stand side by side, walk step by step, meet each other, eye to eye,
and talk, and he can teach us without us being so intimidated, which we do.
Yeah, it's like a baby, you know, looking up at dad, and if dad screams and has the loud voice and, you know, too much light, the baby's going to cry, right? But if father and son are going for a walk on a hike, on a campout trip, and the son is now, you know, at least big enough to be able to keep up with dad and walk with dad and carry a pack along with dad and do some of the chores around the campsite, then, you know, the intimidation factor is completely gone, and it's because the son grew to be more like the dad. God enables us to grow to be more like him, so when we are ultimately confronted with his booming voice and his brilliant majesty, the difference between what he is and what we are will be so mitigated because of what he is doing to increase us that this condition won't exist anymore. This difference won't exist anymore. So we have learned that Yahowah has associated himself with light for a reason that's very important, which is that light is eternal. It is the medium by which he predicts the future and is always right because he has actually witnessed the future, he has participated in the future, and is reporting back in our past, because you can do that if you are light. And the thing that is really exciting to me is the realization that God equates himself to his word and equates himself to light, and the reason that those are the same is that in Hebrew, all verbs are eternally true. They are not stuck in time, just like light is not stuck in time. Now, by calling the light gadol, enormous, important, powerful, and great, even distinguished and intense, a parallel is being drawn to us, prompting us to relate this statement to the prophetic proclamation that we talked about that occurred on the fourth day of creation. To my mind, the fourth day of creation and the fact that God goes on and on and on about the greater light becoming visible as a sign and the lesser light to rule the night or the darkness, it has got to be among the most powerful and important prophecies in the whole Torah. Because it tells us who Yahusha is, it tells us what he's going to do in his association with the Moed, it tells us when he's going to arrive, it tells us that he's a sign of something greater, a symbol of something greater, that, and we need to know that he's a symbol of the light, which is the metaphor God uses for himself.
And one of the other things that should be pointed out here is that Yahweh never said he created the sun on the fourth day. He said it became visible. Yahusha,
correct.
You know, he existed long before he passed through the birth canal of Miriam.
Well, Yahusha, because he is a set-apart manifestation of Yahusha, his existence is eternal. So
sure.
He simply is. Now, he isn't always material. He had he can have as many as he wants. He's chosen seven visits to be material. But as we go through this particular prediction in Yahshua 9, what we're going to learn is that it is brilliantly stated. It's one of those things, aha moments when you read it, that a child is born unto us, but a son is given to us. And so it states that, a baby was born, but it was the son that was given. And as a huge distinction between those. And so, no, there's no birthday for the baby Jesus. So this is equating this with the fourth day of creation, and if you don't make that connection, then you're leaving most of the opportunity for understanding negated. Then Yahweh revealed that during mankind's fourth millennia, as I said, this light would become visible as a sign, as you have said, and visible as a sign is extraordinarily important. When things are visible as a sign, then we're using our ability to observe, to recognize what is being presented to us, directing our attention to the Moed meeting times. Lastly, don't ever look at darkness as being the inverse of light, but instead the absence of light. Because dimmer on the fourth day, the lesser light, and Hasatan is light. He is a malach, and as a malach, he is a energy-based or light-based being. If Halal bin Shakar walked into any room that we were in, we would see him as dazzling light. And he is the one that rules over the darkness. So all the darkness in humankind, all of the human institutions and all of their corruptions are ruled over, influenced by the lesser light. And he is a lot lesser in his light output. Hasatan.
Yeah, and as we well know, a lot of the elite, that they worship Lucifer, right?
I mean, correct. And there is, when you're... It's in
that's
the darkness.
That's the name they use, by the way.
Well, you know, and Lucifer is not a horrible ripoff of the concept that God was trying to convey through Halal bin Shakar. You know, Halal, and it's written two ways. One place it's written as Halal, the other place it's written as Halal. They're slightly different words. But Halal is a duplicitous word. It has a positive and a negative connotation, and you have to, therefore, deduce the meaning by the fact that it is a word with a dichotomy. It's the basis of hallelujah, to radiate Yah's light. And mm-hmm. so it speaks of Halal bin Shakar as being light, and he is. As a malak, he has to be light. He's an eternal being, and therefore in his natural state appears like light. But Halal also conveys arrogance, presumptuousness, pride, being puffed up. And so it has both of those connotations, and that helps to describe the nature of the Prince of Darkness.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So now as we move to the next statement that Yah was going to make, most English translations errantly render goy, which is presented here as singular, as nation. And then they equate it to Yisrael in the following passage. And while there are some uses of goy that can be adapted to Yisrael, it is commonly, in virtually every use, goy is used to mean that which is not Yisrael. So you've got Yisrael and you've got goyim, and they are the inverse of one another. I think there's a place or two where goyim is actually used to describe Yisrael, but it's only being done to say, you know, you guys are so far from what you were supposed to be and have become so much like what you were not supposed to be that I might as well call you what you now have become. And so you have transitioned from Yisrael to goyim. But otherwise, when it's goy is used to be distinct from Yisrael. And this leads us to considerable confusion when it's written just as nation, as opposed to the most complete definition of goy would be people from different races and places. And by different, it's different than Yisrael. You know, Yisrael is both the children of Yisrael and the place Yisrael. So a different place, a different race, is goyim. But people of different races and places, it'd be a much more accurate translation of goy. And it says that they're going to grow, become enriched, and empowered as a result of Yah's light. And, you know, if you look at the arrival of the greater light in year 4000 Yah, 33 CE, and his fulfillment of the Mikre during that time, while the majority of the initial beneficiaries were Yehudim, were Yisraelites.
The offshoots from that were goyim.
Almost exclusively.
Yeah.
And to this day, there are a number of Yisraelites that have come to know Yahweh through the same methods that we have. And you know, there's a physician that may have been the first that I encountered that was Jewish and came to know Yada Yah, having read Prophet of Doom.
Down in Arizona, I believe.
Yeah, actually. And then the technologist that is responsible for our websites and was my good friend with my last business, he's Jewish, and it was through late-night discussions that he said, wait a minute, all of my aunt, the reason I'm an agnostic is I hate religion. I think religion is stupid. And
you're
telling me that God
world.
Hates religion too, and that God thinks religion is stupid. Now,
welcome to Yahweh.
Yeah,
world.
Now then he says, so what are my objections now?
You know, there aren't any.
Yeah, now, now that I don't have any objections to him, because I know that he hates religion as much as I do, what is he really like? And you go and describe what he's really like. Okay, that's exactly as he should be. And so there are, I tell the story only to share that there are lots of Jews who have benefited, even recently, from Yahowah's light. It's just that I think they are in the minority, that for the most part it's people from different races and places that are benefiting right now from this light. Now that's going to change when Yahweh returns on the day of reconciliation. The primary purpose of that day is to reconcile his relationship not with us Goyim, but with Yisrael and with Yehudim. So there will be a day where they will become the majority beneficiaries
of this.
Yeah, and it's good. You know, there are some. This is why I was comfortable having our racial discussion in the beginning of the meeting, Larry. Is that while most judgments based on race are improper, it is appropriate to occasionally have discussions which are race based, and if we can figure out what culturally, what decisions are going wrong with certain races to cause them to be to act badly, then that's helpful. In the case of Yisrael and Yehudim, they became adulterous. They not in the sense of divorcing their spouses and cheating on their spouses, but
they became
the
religious.
Divorcing God and cheating on God. They became religious. They thought they were smarter than God. They thought they were more influential than God. They thought
God had
become an absentee landlord.
It's hard for me to imagine why, you know, if Yahweh will stand with me and protect me and take care of me, why I want to be like everybody else in the world. But, you know, the grass is always greener on the other side of the fence, and that's what happened to them. That's what happened.
Yeah, they thought that they could do a better job on their own, and so they abandoned him, and they suffered the consequences. Yahweh made it very clear what the consequences would be. No people have suffered greater consequences. God didn't do that to them. He didn't bring the Holocaust.
No, he said men would give them their stripes.
Yeah,
and that's what
they brought it on themselves.
And as you pointed out earlier, the most lettered people in the world, probably. Yeah. You know.
But you know, in the back to communities within the United States, that people are more prone to crime and less prone to working and succeeding and keeping their families together and nurturing their families, it is because too high a percentage of that group of people are rejecting God's instructions.
Well, there is one other
thing. They reject them, the worse the situation becomes. That's what happened
right
to Israel.
And there's one other thing that should be pointed out, and it's a direct corollary here to what you're speaking. The African-American community in the United States, and believe me, I was an analyst for the Gallup organization. I was their top analyst in the world for 2 years. Nobody can say that but me. It's never happened before. I can tell you that they are by far, the most religious community in the United States.
Yeah.
Religion kills. It kills.
Yeah, religion
kills. It just destroys everything it touches.
Yeah. The reason our friend William, and I think he's now listening, is such a genuine individual. The reason he has such a wonderful family. The reason that he is our favorite person really to listen to is that William has decided that two things matter to him. Fulfilling the role of father and husband in a family, and his relationship with his Heavenly Father. And as a result of that, so many good things have happened. And when we get away from that, bad things happen. It's just the consequence of, that's what God is saying. I'm going to give you advice. I'm going to give you guidance. If you accept my guidance, if you act upon this guidance, good things are going to happen to you. And if you reject it, bad things are going to happen. Now, he doesn't say that if you accept his guidance during our mortal existence, that everything is going to be perfect. But he does promise a perfect eternity. And he doesn't say that, you know, if you reject his guidance, that everything that you do, you're going to fail. But
no,
you are going to fail on the long term.
There's some very, 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 very worldly successful people that are just rats. I mean, they're just rats, but they're worth, you know, billions and billions and billions of dollars. I mean, we all know that.
Yeah. So here's Yasha Yah, salvation is from Yah.
William on the line now?
He's not on the line, but he is in the chat room because we have signed in William the Elevator Man. And William, not trying to embarrass you, but it is. We began the show and talking about some of the racial fallout of the Zimmerman trial and how people have been indoctrinated and we held you up as our favorite person to call and approach the show because of your attitude and your approach to life, and so that's the reason we're talking about you, William. It's in an entirely positive way. So, you shall increase the people from different races and places, causing them to grow and become great. So, if I may, my view of this is that the benefit of the covenant is that God causes his children to grow. That's his idea of reaching down and out to us and lifting us up, serving us. And God literally serves us as a father serves his children, is because he wants us to grow. He is the source of our growth. He ultimately makes us greater than we would be without him. That's his primary objective. He becomes happy. He finds pleasure in lifting us up and causing us to grow. His pleasure comes the same way that my pleasure does with my sons. That's what trips his trigger. That's why he created the universe. So you shall increase the people from different races and places, causing them to grow. Speaking now of Yahusha, which is the manifestation of Yahweh. By approaching them, you will increase their joy. Now, you know, you can empower someone and actually be counterproductive. You know, there are lots of people around the world who have been empowered, and empowering them was a bad idea. John McCain, you sent me an email, Larry, on John McCain. And what John McCain is promoting an amnesty bill that he doesn't even know what's written in the bill. Empowering him was a bad idea. But if you empower someone in such a way, within the family construct, loving them, nurturing them, sheltering them, teaching them, guiding them, and your very nature is to celebrate, to party, to camp out, to have fun together, then it's not just that you're going to increase the people from different races and places, causing them to grow and become great. By approaching them, you increase our joy. That's what the purpose of God's work and the covenant is to do, is to make us happy. You know, that was the nature of the Garden of Eden. It was happy. It was a happy, fun place. We're going to return to that happy, fun place. And God uses the term pleasure, right? You know, it's one of the things that I have come to embrace about eternity. Because Yahusha, several times after his fulfillment of Bokurim, where he became a spiritual entity, he could still, at any time he wanted, transition some of that spiritual energy into matter to enjoy food, the pleasure and taste of food, of wine, of talking with his friends, you know, sailing a boat on the sea with the sun glistening off the water. There is great pleasure in the material, and we are going to be able to, I think, at any time we wish, to transition some of our spiritual energy into matter, so that we can continue to enjoy singing songs, the psalms that will be so prevalent in eternity, enjoy the great feasts and the great meals together. You know, I expect that the thrill about sitting around a bonfire is going to be practiced with great routine in eternity. Then he says, to complete this thought, they will become delighted and elated. You know, it was simchah. And now it's shamak. They will rejoice, expressing a positive and an upbeat attitude to approach your presence. La Pene. similar to the pleasure in the harvest. Just like the benefits associated with celebrating and receiving an apportionment of property. And they will have been drawn out and separated from prey. So, the purpose of the light approaching us, the purpose of the light being seen in the darkness for those who are engaged and up and walking, is that those who respond to the light and walk to the light are going to grow, ultimately becoming great. That's the fifth promise of the covenant. That we will be able to approach God. Now, approaching God is the purpose of all seven of the Moed Mikre. And that's the doorway to life, the threshold of perfection, the reward of adoption, strengthening, guidance, and empowerment and enrichment. Ultimately, we end up in God's home. So approaching God is the whole purpose of the Moed Mikre. So we become delighted and elated to approach your presence. You know, we have so many references to the 119th Psalm. In the 119th Psalm, there are a couple of times where Dode says, you know, I'm really bothered by those buggers that are anti-Yahowah and are just constantly working against what is good for the people. But most of the time, he is saying, you know, I am just thrilled beyond words. I am one happy dude. I've got a relationship with the Creator God of the universe, and I've got a guaranteed pass, a ticket, to go directly into heaven. And, you know, it's a song of joy. Most of his songs are joyous. And he is delighted to approach Yahweh's presence. Now, similar to the pleasure of a harvest, the reason that the harvest is mentioned here, I think, is manyfold. One is that at a harvest, there's plenty to eat, right? We're going to be constantly celebrating festival feasts.
Oh, yeah, it's party time. Yeah,
right.
Absolutely.
When fruit is being harvested, it's being collected and brought into the storehouse, it's no longer subject to prey and to being eaten by the birds and the worms and all that sort of thing. And so it's something that's being brought into the storehouse of God. It's being celebrated. It's delicious, brings pleasure, nurtures life. The benefits associated also with receiving an apportionment of property for having been drawn out and separated from prey. The term that is used in Greek throughout the Septuagint every time Torah is written is nomos. And at first I was wondering, you know, why was it a Greek word chosen for teaching or direction or guidance? That would have made so much more sense than for Torah than the translation of nomos. But in a way, nomos works pretty well because nomos speaks of the same thing that is being conveyed here, this shalach, which is receiving an apportionment.
And part of the covenant. Yeah.
And as part of the covenant, when we, on Bukurim, we're adopted into Yahweh's family, we receive an apportionment of his property.
Yeah, and that's, and it's just sad that we see the translation law.
It is.
Because you got to get people over that. If they can't get over that hump, then they're like 10 powers. They're stuck with 613 laws.
Right. Yeah, if you can't get over the concept of law, then you're probably never going to get over the concept of obey. And then you're probably never going to get over the concept of Lord.
Or commands or any of the rest of it.
Right. But the purpose of the Moed Mikre, the purpose of the Torah, the purpose of the covenant, is to write us into God's family so that we receive an apportionment of his property.
Is that you, William?
Yeah, hey. How you doing, guys?
Hi.
I was just waiting to get buzzed in.
Yeah, hi. Hi, William.
Hi, Yara. How you doing?
Good. You live in Florida, don't you?
Yes.
So how has your family responded to all of the upheaval after the Trayvon Martin Zimmerman trial?
Well, I have two brother-in-laws that are actually on the they work for the Sanford Police Department.
Yes.
So, you know, it's been kind of mixed feelings about it, but I knew a while ago that he was going to get off because I think one of the things that they never spoke about was that he actually mentored he was a mentor for black kids.
Yes.
His great grandfather was black. His date to the prom was black. I mean, to call Zimmerman a racist is just another one of these canards.
His business partner is black.
Yeah, his business partner is black.
He's from the date to the prom to his business partner, his wife's best friend, their house guest. Was a black man who had lost his house in the neighborhood, and so Zimmerman said, "Oh, just come live with me." And I don't want to make Zimmerman out to be a saint because that would be stupid, but he was the antithesis of a racist, and that's
he was also an Obama voter.
Yeah, I know. That seems amazing.
There is some justice here.
Yeah.
The thing is, I think that there may have been, you know, misunderstanding between the two, and one of the things that you hear all the time is that, you know, he didn't get, you know, he should have listened to the dispatcher's request to, you know, to not follow the kid. So, I mean, there's so, you know, so many different aspects.
Yeah, you know, that's not a dispatcher. It's actually just a 911 operator. That operator has no authority. And I know a lot of people are saying, why didn't he just listen to the operator? The operator has no authority.
Right.
You know, that's a misnomer to think, and I've heard that so many times, that why didn't you just listen? Well, because that person has no authority. He's been trained, and he went and took the training for being a neighborhood watch volunteer. And as a neighborhood watch volunteer, you do, that is your job, is to watch. And,
Right.
So, but you're right, the confrontation took place without, in a way that both misunderstood what the other was doing. One did walk in with a racial attitude, though. I mean, he called Zimmerman, he referred to Zimmerman as using a derogatory term followed by cracker.
Right.
And so Trayvon Martin was not a saint. The boy was kicked out of school 3 times.
Which is why he was up there.
First time he was kicked out of school because he was a truant.
Right.
Second time he was kicked out of school is because of drug possession on school campus. The third time he was kicked out of school is because he was defacing school property by writing "What the F," and when they brought him in for defacing school property, he was in the possession of stolen property.
With a burglar tool, by the way.
Yeah, with a burglar tool. So he was no saint, and he was intoxicated that night. He would, he was kicked out of school for using marijuana. He was using marijuana that night. He had a toxicology report that shows him using marijuana that night. And he didn't go to buy a bag of Skittles because he had a sugar rush.
He was making lean.
Lean is a very powerful, intoxicating drug. And so there is all of the evidence of the eyewitnesses say the same thing, that Trayvon Martin picked the fight, and therefore he had the greater hand in his own death.
Wow.
Is it a shame that the young boy is dead? Yes, but we can't make him into a saint.
Right. And you know, I think the only reason that case, was exposed the way it was is because, you know, these certain individuals got involved, and, you know, they decided to make it a circus act, and, I refuse to say their name and give them any kind of shine because it's just not worth it. But long story short, it's just because it was in the eyes of the media. And, you know, there's cases like that, if not worse, every single day.
Here's my concern over what happened is that I'm going to use different words, but I think I'm going to say the same thing you just said, William, which is that there are liberal leaders and African-American leaders whose voice had gone, they weren't in the limelight. They saw an opportunity to get in the limelight again and to be seen important, and so they took a case where it was obvious that there was no racial aspect of this case. They took a case where it was obvious that if the case was tried, they would lose. And they presented the case to the African-American community as this was a boy armed with nothing but Skittles, and this white guy went in and murdered him in cold blood. And they knew that if it was brought to trial, they would lose. I mean, I studied the evidence on this case the day that it happened, and for the weeks afterwards, I read everything there was to read, and I made a statement that there is a zero possibility of a conviction here. And so, based on the evidence. And so, I think leaders of the African-American community deliberately lied and misrepresented the facts to African-Americans for the express purpose of knowing that this verdict would happen, and when it happened, they would be enraged, and then they would be empowered as the now all of a sudden in the limelight, speaking on behalf of a disenfranchised community. And it was deliberately orchestrated to empower rotten people and to make other people mad. And the thing that really got me angry about the whole thing is that the protest thereafter, you saw children out there with anger in their faces that were mimicking their parents' anger. And and blaming someone else for their problem. I mean, we need to realize that if we don't parent our children so that they make good choices, so that they choose not to use drugs, they choose to go to school and not be truants, they choose not to deface school property, they choose not to to view the world in a way that somebody is holding me down, but instead is the world is this is my opportunity, you know. The way we raise our children has an enormous influence on them.
Absolutely.
And that's the tragedy, I think, of the Trayvon Martin thing, is everyone is blaming the wrong place. We need to look in the mirror and say, well, maybe we're accountable.
I agree with that 150%. You're right. I mean, it's all about the parents, bottom line. You know,
yeah, and so... The connection I was making, William, to this, and I used your name in the beginning of the program, is that there is a problem right now in the African-American community. And I think the root of the problem is the lack of commitment in terms of men and women getting married, staying married in families so that African-American children have the opportunity to be raised in a loving, supporting family where dad works for a living and mom not only nurtures the children, but she can work too, but she plays, both parents play a role of making sacrifices to lift up and shelter and nurture their children so that their children grow and have opportunity, and that they guide their children and protect their children and make sacrifices for their children. In that environment, children don't do what Trayvon Martin did. And
right.
When we take that family, the covenant, if you will, and fathers doing the right thing by way of their wives and their children, out of a community where it becomes uncommon in the community, bad things happen.
Yeah, in fact, I think that... it's safe to say that that's actually a common problem within America itself, where divorce is at a rampant rate right now. Everybody's getting divorced. You know, no one looks at marriage as a sacred thing anymore. It's just like, you know, actually, when I got married, the judge looked at me and said, you know, son, you know, just as easily as I married you, I could divorce you, too. You know, it's just one piece of paper, a signature, and you're done. I just couldn't believe that he was telling me that. You know, it's supposed to be the happiest day of my life, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, he's trying to line you up for the divorce right away. That's pretty funny.
But there's something else that we talked about, William, that I think is, and your point is well taken, that while this appears to be a problem that is more widespread, it's a higher percentage of the African-American community where the family is no longer valued. But it is becoming, unfortunately, it's becoming pervasive across America. I think there's another problem that is pervasive across America that has a higher percentage application in the African-American community that is creating another problem. and that is dependency as opposed to working. There is so much to gain by working that, you know, when you contribute and you do something in your work that creates benefit, you feel good about yourself. You know that what you have and you can give to your children cost you something, and so it means more when you can provide it for your family and your children. It's just, and there's a draining aspect of having spent a day and not worked and not made a contribution. And I think I think we have a problem with too few people valuing the benefit of work.
Absolutely, you know, and it's one of the things that I think is getting pretty old is, you know, especially in urban America, is, you know, I'm from the ghetto. I've never been given the opportunity, and so on and so forth. I think, you know, that's kind of getting played out, if you will, because, you know, I'm from the Bronx, and, you know, I'm not a, you know, a multimillionaire or anything, but, you know, I made it out. You know, I do what I can for my family. So you're right. It's just the fact that everybody wants a hand-me-down. Nobody
right.
wants to do anything anymore. You know,
and, but you
really
know, when you work for a living, don't you get a sense of satisfaction from that? I know I did.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's, I enjoy getting up every day and feeling like I've accomplished something.
Yeah.
You know.
And even if you know that some of your work wasn't fun, although a lot of work is fun, but some of your work wasn't fun, you still gain something that you were able to give to your family, and that's
right.
fun.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. I think the covenant is really that way, that God makes coming to know him and coming to understand all that he's offering and all that we have to avail ourselves of so that we grow and learn. I think he has made it work for that exact purpose, that when we view working for knowledge, working to learn, working to help our children understand, when we begin to look at work and engaging as a positive thing, then we have the right attitude and mindset that God is looking for.
Right. I mean, that's how I feel about my relationship with him. You know, I've worked hard years to come to know the truth. And, you know, now that I know that I'm there, you know.
Yes.
And it's just so awesome. I mean, the bond to me is, you know, it's unbreakable.
Well, I like the way you say that. Now you know you're there. There it is.
Yeah.
There's knowledge versus
yeah.
faith.
Yeah.
You know, you
that
feel
was a big
like
difference for me, too. That was
yeah,
the thing. I think that's something that's common with all of us, is that
yeah.
when we had faith, we pretended, and yet Yahowah is so knowable, so approachable, so demonstrative, and there's just this, there's no ego associated with saying, I know that I'm there. It's just a quiet confidence that becomes so obvious that you just simply relax in it. It's like saying, you know, I know my dad loves me.
Right. Right.
Well, the knowledge you have is eons ahead of anything else you were ever taught, isn't it? I mean, really?
Absolutely.
I mean,
you have
this knowledge base that's beyond anything you've ever known, and you're sitting there with it, and you have answers that people really need. I mean, and you
right.
know it. I mean,
but you know what I think amazes me the most is that it was never really complicated. Just man overcomplicated the situation. You know, they corrupted Yahweh's word, and that's where the issue, you know,
yeah.
was.
And William, if I were to give there's a lot of reasons I like you and respect you. But
well, he doesn't know
were,
you, William.
But if I were to if I were to boil it down to one thing, it would be what you just said. And that is that the thing that strikes me about somebody who really knows Yahowah and who is in a genuine relationship with him, they exude a singular concept, which is that none of this is complicated. It is very simple. Yahweh is our Heavenly Father. He created a family, and his idea of a good time is us exploring and learning together. And if you just view him as a dad and the role of a loving father in a human relationship, you got it. There's really nothing more to it than that. Now, hopefully I'm not putting words in your mouth, but that's what exudes out of your attitude and your tone and your approach and your words. And I think it is an absolute perfect match for Yahweh's presentation of himself.
Thank you. Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. I mean, you know, I tell my kids, I tell my friends, my family, you know, people that are religious, you know, even within my family and friends, and I just say, you know, he's dad. Just how do you feel about your children? You know, do you want your children to fear you? Do you want your children to bow down before your feet and so on? And that just starts to, you know, you see their face like, wow, you know, I said, you know, this is how I look at it. I think about my emotions, the way I feel about my kids, how much I love them, how much I'm willing to do anything for them to keep them safe and so on and provide for them. And, you know, at the end of the day, that's what Yahweh wants for us. That's it. It's just that simple. You know,
yeah, and you can take it one step further, William, in that as a father, when you speak to your children and you say to them, you know, if you have lots of choices, but I want you to know that if you choose to go over there and become religious, if you choose to instead withdraw from society by your dress, your mannerism, your friends, your attitude, or by drugs, that those choices will be harmful to you. They will hurt you. It'll hurt me that you didn't listen to this advice, and it will you know, tear my heart out. But it's your choice, and I want you to know that there's choices you can make that will really hurt you and stunt your growth and hurt the family. And there's choices you can make, children, that will serve you the rest of your life and for all eternity. And here's the advice and the guidance for the good choices, and here's the warning and guidance for the bad choices. Now, I see the Torah and Yahowah in exactly that role and exactly that simple. And I think that when we as a people ignore his advice and do the opposite of what he is suggesting, I think it hurts. I think it pains him.
Yeah, I mean, it's with you, right? As a father to your children, if your kids didn't take your advice, you would be in, you know, in pain. I mean, you'd be hurt.
Particularly
right?
when you know that advice will hurt them.
Well, we don't have to think. I mean, we know full well that before the flood, he was sorry he ever made man. He was sad about it.
Right. Now, I share that with you because I think it's related to your willingness to you're sharing the fatherly nature of Yahweh, which is where I always start to. But I think it goes one step further, and then you take fatherly advice, and he has provided his fatherly advice in his Torah, and yet Christians hate the Torah. They reject the Torah, and how's that any different than you telling your children, you know, kids, if you choose to go out and get intoxicated, bad things are going to happen. And if you choose to spend time with us as a family talking about our relationship with Yahweh, good things are going to happen. How is that any different than people rejecting the Torah and saying, hey, God, I want to go in a totally different way. I'm going to create a different God and a different path and a different approach, and I'm going to ignore yours.
Okay.
So doesn't that present religion in the rebellious mode?
Right.
Well, I mean, it clearly does, but, you know, you're also talking about taking a part of yourself, becoming a human manifestation, and allowing your very creation to spit on you, mock you, crucify you, beat you. I mean, Yah went way out of his way to say, look, here I am, you know.
William, I don't know if you've had this experience, but I've had it, where your children, because you're telling them that they've made a choice that is harmful to them, and that you know, it's just inappropriate, and they are mad at you. Have you ever had your children, you know, try to box you a little bit, and the most hurtful things, or say words that are, you know, spiteful? I don't know. Maybe yours are too young to have reached that point, well, there was a period of time where mine did that. That's not a lot different than what mankind did with Yahusha. We kicked at him and spit at him and said dirty things to him and nasty things to him. And, you know, but that's what fathers do, though. They put themselves in a position knowing that, you know, I might get hurt, but it's still the right thing for me to do.
That's true. That's true. I actually have a question for you.
Sure.
A good friend of mine, he was actually my boss years ago, and now we're working together again. I accepted a job with a new company. So long story short, he and I, we had a discussion. He's currently a Christian, but he's second-guessing. You know, he's right, you know, which is what I said. And we had a discussion a couple of weeks ago. And today on our way out of work, he stopped me. He said, you know, I've been thinking about, you know, what you said the other day. And I was so encouraged, by the way. I was like, wow, this is awesome. Because, you know, like me, it just makes sense to him.
Right.
And you know, just started with the basics, you know, the name and Jesus and the letter J and so on.
Right.
And how it's approximately only 500 years old. And I said, you know, just do your own research, and because I don't ever want to push anybody in any direction. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I encouraged him to listen in on the show.
By the way,
that's
brilliant, the idea that so many people like to, once they come to know the truth, they want to push people because they know it's so good. But the very fact that you say, I'm gonna give you information that will help you, but you've got to capitalize on it.
Right.
Yeah, wait for that response.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah,
and that's the way Yahweh is, by the way. You can't go wrong by following God's example. That's God's example. Another brilliant decision.
Yeah, I've always felt that way. I see Yahusha's example, and I just don't see him knocking on the door like the Jehovah Witnesses.
No.
I don't see that in Scripture anywhere.
No, he's not going door to door trying to convince anybody.
Right.
No.
To me, it was his conduct and the way that he, acted on a day-to-day basis, which is what attracted people to him. You know, he was a Torah, you know, in the flesh. He walked it. He talked it.
Yeah.
You know?
He was not Machiavellian, where the ends justified the means. He wasn't Sun Tzu, where the enemy of my enemy is my friend, and I'm going to form allegiances and alliances this way. Just straightforward, you know. I'm going to tell you where to look for answers. If you want to look there and engage with me, great. I'm going to meet you halfway, and we're going to have a great old time. But if you don't, that's your choice. Yeah, no, that's right. So leading to what's the question? I want to make sure we get this.
Question,
we only have 4 minutes.
Yeah, his question was, he says, you know, William, I know that the scripture, in Scripture, I think it's in the eyewitness account, says that, I believe Yahusha said, Yahweh chooses us, we don't choose him. And so, you know, I was wondering, I mean, I know that you translate a lot, or you try to, you know, look at the Hebrew and Greek meanings of these words, and so what do you feel about that scripture?
What
is it accurate?
First of all, it's not scripture because it's not Hebrew.
Okay, I'm sorry.
But and if I knew precisely the passage and could look it up and look at the Greek beneath it and then look to see if we have a pre-Constantine manuscript, I could answer the question. So what I promise to do is I will find the statement and I will look at the Greek and this time next week I'll be prepared to give a good answer on that. But let me give you at least a top of awareness answer. Yahweh did choose us.
Okay.
He did choose us. He chose to create the universe for us. He chose to make the sacrifice of Pesach and Matzah and Bukurim on our behalf. He chose to offer us the covenant. He went to Abraham and said, you know, I want to have a relationship with you. And he went to Yishak and said, I want to have a relationship with you. And he went to Jacob and said, I want to have a relationship with you. He went to the children of Israel who were slaves in Egypt and muddy up to their gills and said, I want to have a relationship with you. I want you to be my children. I think Yahweh chooses us. And then, based upon his choice to have a relationship with us, we can respond and choose to meet him in his home. But I think that's how we started this whole program, is that the greater light became visible to us, and for those who are walking in darkness who chose to approach him, that that they could capitalize on the light becoming visible to us. I think Yahweh has chosen us just as he chose Moses, just as he chose Dode. I think he chooses us and then gives us the opportunity to respond. And to the degree that he just plays favorites, and we're going to go past the recording time here, William, but I'll spend just a few more minutes on this. The fact that he plays favorites is his prerogative. Now, for the most part, I think that Yahweh chooses all of us, and it's a matter of whether or not we respond and choose to reciprocate. That's the nature of a relationship. But to some degree, William, I think that God does make choices. I think there's some personalities that I think that he absolutely went to Abraham. He could have picked anybody in the world. He picked Abraham. There was something in Abraham's personality and character and intellect and psyche that he liked, and he chose that man. Now, Abraham could have rejected him. He chose Moshe. And there was something in Moshe's character and nature that he liked. He said, I want to work with you. You want to work with me? I think that that he reached out to you, William. And you responded. I feel like he did that for me. I feel like he did it for Larry. I feel like he did it for each of us. That there's something about us that he liked. Now, in you, it's easy to see. In me, I look at me and I say, I'm not so sure what he saw in me. Other than maybe make him laugh with all my foibles, but I think he does. I think he. And why shouldn't he have the right? He created the whole universe. And you know what, your friend, when he says to you that God has to choose us, Yahweh has to choose us, and I say, okay, he chose me, and I chose him right back. And the very fact now that you're one of the few people that, because of my relationship with Yahweh, are being exposed to who he is, are you not being chosen, my friend? How are you going to respond?
Yeah.
So without looking at what the words themselves say in Greek, because we know the Greek is a translation of what he spoke in Hebrew, and whether it's something that the context helps define the whole thing, that's what I would say is, yeah, he did. He chose me, and I chose him right back. And now you're giving the same opportunity. He's choosing you. Are you going to respond?
I think, right, yeah. I think your answer was great, actually. Praise Yahweh for that, because right out the gate, and this is coming off the top of your head, I thought that was brilliant. You said he created us, so he did choose us.
And yeah, he did.
It's that simple, right there.
He absolutely did. And he chose us for his family. But once he chooses us, that's as far as God's going to go. He's not going to beg us. He's not going to force us. He's not going to drag us. At that point, they say the ball is in our court. We've got to decide, do we want to take the ride or not?
Like you say all the time, I want to take that elevator straight to the top.
What I was thinking as I was talking to you, man, I'd push the top floor of the elevator. I'd like that. As I was sharing that with you, that's exactly what I was thinking. I didn't want you to think that I was abusing the elevator metaphor, but it is perfect.
No, that's fine.
I promise you, I'll do this. In fact, maybe even the easier way to do it, too, is that if you will go to yadaya.com or the introduction to God.com or just email at yadayahweh.com. To contact us at either one of those sites, or if you email at yadayahweh.com, it'll come to me. And if you send me an email, then I'll know how to reach you. And I will, this weekend, I'll find the passage, I'll do the translation, I'll try to set in context, and I'll give you a more complete answer.
Okay. Well, I thank you for that. Thank
sure.
You.
Sure, I love what you're doing.
I'm just, listen, it's sad already that, so many people reject Yahowah. So, I won't ever reject them, and I just want to, just share it. I kind of feel guilty if I don't at least, when people say Jesus, tell them it's kind of like what you said, right? We have to be compassionate. So,
right.
I think that that's definitely a manifestation of being compassionate, just telling
right.
the truth.
Well, I don't think there's
anything
religion, you can do more compassionate than telling
think,
people the truth,
I
or more hateful
is,
than allowing people to continue to destroy their lives based upon a lie.
And religion is responsible for turning a lot of people away from Yahowah. I know it did my dad.
Yeah, today we spent all day, just like we did yesterday, on the second of the three instructions that Yahowah engraved in stone, and it is precisely on one thing. He said, you can either embrace me as your father in the covenant, or you can be religious. But if you're religious, you need to know that you're corrupting your own children. And why would you want to do that? And that's really what the second instruction that Yahowah etched in stone. He says, I'm just like William. I'm jealous and passionate about my family. I don't want my wife running off with somebody else. I don't want my children going into an environment that harms them. I'm jealous. I'm passionate about my family. And I really don't like it when dads corrupt their children and through the twisted notions of religion.
Well, I mean, when you're sitting there taking Yahweh's nature and you're turning him into a religious deity, you've just turned Yahowah into Satan. And
yes, you sure have.
Religion is just a pathetic.
Yeah.
Pathetic
so what you're doing, William, is the compassionate and loving thing to do. You know it. Your approach is absolutely perfect. And to the degree that there is something else to learn from the actual context of the words of that statement. I'll look it up for you, and I'm never embarrassed to tell you. I don't know the answer off the top of my head, but I'm always willing to do what you're willing to do, which is God's nature is so simple. The opportunity we're being offered is so straightforward, so easy to understand, that I'm always willing to apply the simple truth of who He is and what His covenant is to give the most likely answer to every question, because you just go right to the root of it. He's dad, and is chosen to have a family, so He's chosen us.
Yada, one of the things I appreciate about you is that, what you just said, you don't profess to know it all. You don't claim that by any means. And so, in my line of work, whenever a technician tells me that he knows it all, I know right away that that's a dangerous individual.
Yeah.
And most of the time, I'm right. That person gets hurt, or he hurts someone else. My line of work, you're consistently learning. Every single day there's something new to learn.
But can you imagine how dull life would be if you weren't learning?
It'd be
pretty
boring.
Isn't learning the fun part of life?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And, you and I both know that we don't know it all. Or anywhere close, but we do know where to go to find the one that does know it all.
Absolutely. You guys may not know it all. I know. I definitely don't
know
it all. But you and Larry and so many people in the family, I got to tell you, I've never been surrounded by so many intelligent people in my life, honestly.
I think that's really true. And I have come to the conclusion that while I'm a millionth as smart as Dode was. Dode is the most brilliant mind I have ever encountered in terms of a human mind. But I am convinced that Yahowah actually does appreciate intellect. And intellect, you don't have to be the world's fastest processor in terms of the mind speed. But God values those who are interested in knowing and learning and understanding. And so when, the difference between knowing a scholar knows many things and understands almost nothing, when you have the right perspective and you have a basic understanding of why the universe exists and why we're here, then when you gather knowledge, the knowledge leads to understanding and it makes sense. And so the kind of intelligent response naturally flows out of what Yahweh is all about. Mm-hmm. I think it's a characteristic of his family. I agree with you.
Well, doesn't he even say, I mean, in Scripture, he says that his people are all destroyed for lack of knowledge.
Right.
Lack of knowledge, right?
What would the opposite of that be?
My
people grow.
Right, right.
Yeah, based on knowledge,
right? Right, absolutely.
Yeah.
Right.
So
right.
My people are saved, and they grow based on knowledge would be the antithesis of that, and that's what I think what he's trying to tell us.
So my people are smart.
My people are smart, you know.
My people are smart, right.
You know, Einstein was a pretty smart guy, and Einstein recognized that you have the right answer when the right answer is simple.
Right.
E equals MC squared is unbelievably elegant and simple, and yet is stunningly profound. That gets right back to the point that I was making earlier, reemphasizing what you said. It's really simple. Who God is, who Yahweh is, what he is offering, what he is like, what he wants, it's really simple. And once you get to the simplicity of it, then you've got it. That's the truth.
Well, it's hard. It's really hard for people to understand that simplicity equals perfection, too, because we've been taught everything's complicated. When in fact it's not. But if you really look at the Torah from start to finish, it's seamless. It's perfect. It's unbelievably perfect.
Yeah. And simple is not simplistic, though. That's the only place where we have to be a little careful, is that while it is simple, it isn't simplistic in the sense of there is so much to learn, there's so much to know, there's so much to understand. There is this relationship isn't the idea of once you have the kernel, okay, Yahweh is Father, thank you very much. Now, you still need to know, well, what are the terms of the Father's family? Are there conditions for us participating in the family?
Yeah, but you and I, year after year after year after year, and thanks to a lot of your hard work, Yada, I grow every year.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yeah.
What I knew
three
years ago is not what I know today. And you know, hopefully what I know 3 years from now is not what I know today. All I know is there's this incredible amount of knowledge that can be ascertained here. And yes, it is simple, but there's a lot of knowledge, and there's a lot that goes into it, and there's a lot of study. I mean, there's a lot of thoughtfulness that goes into this.
When I say simple, by the way, guys, what I'm saying is this. What I told my buddy today is I said, look, the minute that you feel that you're bound, then it's all wrong. I said, because the Torah is liberating.
That's exactly right.
You're free in the Torah, and that's it. And I told him, do your own homework.
It's the same people. There was a big write-up that Ken Power did to one of our people, Paula. Paula was making great strides with this Christian woman, and Ken Power jumped in and said, oh, she's mouthing Craig Wynn's work and don't listen to her, and I don't know what happened to Craig, and you know, he disavows the entire New Testament. I said, well, the whole concept of the New Testament is wrong. Of course it's wrong, you know. Bottom line is, you know, there's a guy that's pretty well studied in his verses, isn't he?
Yeah.
And he knows Scripture inside and out, doesn't he? But he can't get around the Torah and 613 laws because he doesn't get it.
Yeah, and
he
getting it.
Matter of fact, he said he can no longer understand anything you say. That's what he said. Right. He can no longer. And I said, well, that doesn't surprise me because the author of confusion is Satan. And what I find is when I lay Yahweh's real words right down in front of anybody, if they don't know him, they're confused. They're confused.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. And so, I'm completely agreeing with you, William, that ultimately it is a very simple formula, very simple understanding, and yet there is such richness in all of the shadings and all of the ramifications of it that it is an eternal opportunity to learn and to celebrate learning and exploring, and yet the core of who Yahweh is and what he's offering is so enormously simple. And I view it very much like the E equals MC squared Einstein principle of this, so I'm agreeing with you. I've got my wife is texting me and said that she's got challenges right now that are family related and wants me to jump off the program so I can talk with
her. You're agreeing with her, so
we'll see. I am like you guys are. I am happily married, and to be happily married, I prioritize my relationship with my wife.
There you go.
So I'm going to say goodbye so I can go prioritize my relationship
okay,
with my
buddy.
Wife. Yeah, okay. William, thank you,
have
man, for
day.
Calling in.
Good
and,
talking
have
to you,
a great
William.
Shot.
Thank you. Thank you,
okay.
guys.
Thank you, Larry.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.